Hello, everyone. My name's Dave. It's lovely to meet you here. Lovely to sweat with you together this morning. I love the movies. Put your hand up if you love the movies. Okay, who doesn't love movies? Okay, I'm not talking about watching movies at home. I love going to the cinema. Firstly, the cinema is the coldest place in Australia. You've got to bring a jacket to the cinema, which I really like. Really like that. But I love, actually, the experience of going and just being in solitude. I'm part of a secret society of people who go to the movies on their own. Anyone else do that? Yeah. You know what I'm talking about. Just go and everyone else get out. Boom. I love it. One of the reasons I love going on my own is because I love eating. I love the popcorn. I'm addicted to post-mix Coke. Okay, so I just love going there. When I go with my wife will come with me and we'll go to the candy bar and she'll stand there and she'll go, I'll have a bottle of water. I'll have a cup of water. Cup of water. You can have a bottle, darling. We can afford a bottle of water. It's fine. She goes, I'll just have a cup of water. And we get in there and we sit down. Lights go boom, down, and out of the corner of my eye, this hand to my popcorn, my Coke, and it's gone. It's unbelievable. Anyway, listen, I want to talk to you a little bit about movies. I've noticed in all my years of movie watching, I don't know if you've seen this before, that all films, a lot of films, pretty much have the same storyline. Have you noticed that? It's all about this titanic struggle of good versus bad slash, evil slash trial. It could be a romantic comedy. It could be a tragedy. It doesn't matter what genre the film is. It's all about a hero or heroes overcoming something, a romantic situation or an illness or a war or whatever it is. And so you know who to go for. You go for the goodie versus the baddie. Okay, and we, we're suckers. We all do that. I think the Hollywood producers know what they're doing. They keep just sort of putting out these films that are all like each other for a reason. Because I think we view our lives in the same way as these Hollywood producers produce films. We like to view our lives as the goodies, the hero, in a struggle against some sort of trial. I mean, it doesn't matter where you're from here today, all of us are going through some sort of struggle, big or small. And so we all view ourselves as the hero in our own film going against this titanic battle, and we love going and, cheering for ourselves in that battle. Now, there's a wicked irony in this, though. I don't know if you've noticed it before. It's very, very possible that even though you're the hero in your own story, you are simultaneously playing the role of the baddie in someone else's. You see, all of us are trying to push forward our own motivations and our own desires. And often, the trial and the struggle that we have in our lives is when other people are doing the same thing. Amen? Is that what we're doing? And we're all bumping up against each other. And so we're struggling against each other. The passage of the Bible we just had read out to us, it's one of the biographies of Jesus, is a classic story like this. Good versus bad. Bad way to live versus good way to live. Righteousness versus unrighteousness. Authenticity versus hypocrisy. And in many ways, I promise you, you're going to enjoy this story because it's just like a Hollywood film. We know who to go for. We can boo the baddies and sort of cheer for the goodies. Jesus interacts with real people at a real time and teaches us a real lesson. There's no doubt about that. But I must warn you, there's a little bit of a twist in the sermon today. I want to put a challenge out for you. As we look at the main characters in this story, I want you to ask yourself, which one am I? Which character here best reflects my life and the way that I actually interact with people? Will you do that for me today? So let me give you a little bit of background about what's happening with Jesus. The day is a Wednesday. It's the last Wednesday he will ever have as a human on earth before he gets crucified. Okay, this is actually all taking place in the last week of Jesus' life. He's in Jerusalem. He spent 3 years sort of preaching in the countryside. And now he's in the center, the capital city is in Jerusalem. And he's in the temple in the center of Jerusalem, kind of like the church in the middle. And Jesus is spending all day on this last week interacting with people. Probably got his sweat on too. He's in the Middle East, let's be honest. He's probably doing plenty of this as he's doing it. Okay, he's interacting with the people. He's teaching and he's preaching. We learn about this in Luke chapter 20. That's what he's doing. But he's also having mad confrontations with people, like big beefs with people and arguments with the religious rulers and the authorities. They keep trying to trip him up. They've got murder on their mind because they're trying to get him to trip up and to say something where they can arrest him. So he has these big confrontations, but he has these big moments of teaching. And it gets to the end of the day and Jesus is just exhausted. Okay, you can empathize with him. He's been talking all day. And he gets to the point now where he decides, okay, I'm going to turn to my small group of disciples now, not the big crowd, just a small group of disciples, and I'm going to give them my final word for the day. And you might think his final word is, hey, you've done really well today. Let's go down to the pub. Let's chill out. Or listen, thank you so much for coming. I can't wait to see you later on. Whatever. That's not what he says. He gives them a warning. This is his last thought for the day, and he gives them a warning. And what he says is actually completely revolutionary. Check out what he says in verse 46. It'll come on the screen here. Jesus looks at them and he says, beware of the teachers of the law. Now, who are these guys, teachers of the law? Well, believe it or not, they're religious leaders. When it says the law, it's talking about the first half of the Bible, the Old Testament, that these guys were the religious rulers who implemented the law in their religious society. So they're kind of like this combination of religious leaders and lawyers. I'm sure they'd be really popular. Everyone loves religious people and lawyers, right? I mean, together in one person. So you've got, no offense to any lawyers, we love you guys. So you've got these guys who have legal precedence in their society, but also are greatly respected. Okay, this is a very religious culture. These men represented God. Very, very respectable. And Jesus says to his guys, watch out for the teachers of the law. Why? Well, have a look what happens next. This is the warning he gives. They like to walk around in flowing robes and love to be greeted with respect in the marketplaces and have the most important seats in the synagogues and the places of honor at banquets. Now, you might think, well, so what? I like to go to banquets. I've never been to one, but they sound fun. You know, I like to get the respect of people. But you've got to understand something here. These men are meant to represent God. Their interests and their motivations are not meant to be me. They're meant to be he. They're not meant to be in it to make a buck, to get respected so people can like them and think they're amazing and get all the tickets to the great parties and all the perks. But they did. Their entire motivation was self. They wanted to be respected. They wanted to be liked. And they did it by pretending to be doing and acting on the behalf of God for the good of the people. But the reality is they were just lying in their own pockets. So that's the first warning Jesus gives. Watch out for these guys. They've got ulterior motives. Are we on board? Okay, good. I know I'm speaking quickly. I'll slow down. Okay, good. What happens next? That's the first part of the warning. Let's have a look what his second says. They devour widows' houses. If you're a widow in the ancient world, it is a terrible plight. You see, women could not inherit. Did you know that in the ancient world, women could not inherit? The inheritance of the husband would go to the closest male heir. And if that closest male heir had no love or affection for the widow would become destitute, and that would happen a lot. The first half of the Bible, called the Old Testament, spends a lot of time commanding God's people to care for the widows and the orphans. They were just the oppressed and the really, really destitute people in that society. The religious leaders were meant to be leading that charge. We're meant to be the top dogs at caring for these people. They had legal authority looking after wills and looking after testaments and all this stuff. But instead, they took advantage of these women. They stole their estates. Can you believe that? They took their money. They tricked them and fooled them into selling their properties at very small prices, and then they would buy them back themselves. They were the ones who, instead of being kind and considerate, were cruel. They were the ones who, as Jesus puts it, and isn't this a horrific but beautiful way of putting it, they devoured widows' houses. Isn't that incredible? He ate them. So you've got these guys all about the self and all about lying in their own pockets. But then Jesus says something that is the worst of all. It might surprise you. It's that same reading, if I can get that same passage put back on. They devour widows' houses and for a show make lengthy prayers. Why is that the worst thing? You see, what they are doing in the name of religion. The authority and the respect which they have in their culture came because they claim to be representing God. And rather than represent God, They disgraced his name. It was a wicked way to act. And in God's opinion, in Jesus' opinions, the most wicked. That they would not only destroy people's lives, but they would do it allegedly on behalf of God. You know, these men were the moral standard bearers of the society. They'd go around and they would give permission for people to execute people and stone people to death for failing morally. And yet these men were the worst of all. They had a standard for everyone else, which they imposed, and they would get nowhere near it. Now, we've got a word for someone like that in our society, don't we? What's the word that we use? Hypocrite, thank you very much. Not hippopotamus, hypocrite. Okay, these men are hypocrites. And trust me, no one likes hypocrites. No gangster rappers are rapping about how cool it is to be a hypocrite. Maybe a bank robber, but not a hypocrite. Okay, no one likes hypocrites. The whole do as I say, not as I do. You heard that before? Maybe you've said that before. The whole double standards. The whole I'll say one thing, but do another. Now that's your stock standard hypocrisy. But these guys were different type of hypocrites. They were what I call moral hypocrites. Let me try and explain that by embarrassingly confessing something about my own life to you. Now, don't tell anyone this, okay? When I was a teenager, for a brief 6-month period, I became a vegan. I'm deeply ashamed. Now, there's nothing wrong with veganism. If you don't know what that is, that's a vegetarian who doesn't drink milk or dairy or whatever. You will not be surprised to find out the reason and motivation behind my conversion to veganism had something to do with a woman. Okay, I was 15, so a girl. I was interested in a girl who was a vegan and she wouldn't go out with someone who ate meat. So quickly, I had an overnight conversion to animal rights. I very suddenly started caring about animals when I'd never given two stuffs about animals ever in my life. So out goes the meat, out goes the milk. Mum, you got to buy me soy milk. Mum, you got to get lentils and tofu. And my mum's just thinking, what are you? But you know, she's a good woman. But the worst part of all wasn't that I was a vegan. And if you're a vegan, God bless you. There's nothing. It's great, wonderful, fantastic. The worst part of all wasn't that I was a vegan. It's that I became a moral campaigner for veganism. Around my dinner table, they'd be tucking into chicken and chips. And I'd be like, murderer, you murderer, how could you do that? You have no soul. And my dad would be drinking a glass of milk. I'd be like, oh, you're inhumane. You know, with his milk moustache, what? You're inhumane. How could you do that? But the truth was, I wasn't a vegan. I'd set my alarm for 12:30 every night and come down and eat every piece of meat I could possibly get from the fridge. Man, I would like crunch bones. I'd be getting milk and be like, glug, 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 glug. Like it was, you know, the most precious drink you've ever had. My mum cottoned onto it, so she would draw a line on the milk container. I had to catch me, but I cottoned onto her scheme, so I'd fill up the milk bottle with water. And then my sister would be like, why does this taste watery? And I'm like, oh, maybe it's your guilt that makes it taste watery, Anna. Oh, man. I was a hypocrite. I was a full-on hypocrite. I wish I was making that story up. There's not a part of it that is. Where am I? Okay. You see, there's your stock standard hypocrite, and then there's your hypocrite who maintains a moral standard for everyone else but refuses to meet it themselves. So that's the baddies of the story. We've met the bad guys, haven't we? We met the villains, the hypocrites. But Jesus isn't finished here. He now introduces us to another character. Another few characters, actually. So have a look what happens next in chapter 21 of Luke, verse 1 to 4. He finishes up talking about religious rulers, and then, verse 1, Jesus looked up, just got his crew of disciples, he looked up and he saw the rich putting their gifts in the temple treasury. Now, that's kind of like the offertory at church, but, you know, times a million, okay? The temple treasury had like 13 giving containers. They're made out of metal and they're shaped like a funnel, okay? And so people would bring their money, big chests of money, and they'd throw it into these metal funnels. And what do you think that did? Huge sound, boom, 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 as the money threw down. So the rich people, they love to go there to this, you know, place in front of everyone, heaving with their big, probably equivalent of like a novelty-sized check, you know. And, oh, and throw it in and all this money, and everyone be like, oh, look at these men and women. How godly, how generous of them. So maybe they're the goodies. They're the ones who are really given a lot. Well, let's keep looking. What does Jesus say next? Verse 2, he also saw a poor widow put in two very small copper coins. You know, in the Greek, it gives you the actual value of those coins. Combined, it's 1/8 of a cent. This woman, this poor widow, dressed like a widow, dressed in ragged clothing, threw in, what sound do you think that made in the metal funnel giving container? Nothing. No one was noticing her. No one was impressed with her. So let's be honest and clear with each other. On a pragmatic level alone, the wealthy gave more financially than the poor. Will you agree with that? They gave more money. So are they the heroes of this story? Well, listen to what Jesus says next in verse 3. Truly I tell you, this poor widow has put in more than all the others. Hold on again, what? No, she hasn't. What does he mean? Well, verse 4. All these people gave their gifts out of wealth, but she, out of her poverty, put in all she had to live on. Now, let's just spend a minute here understanding what Jesus is saying when he says she gave more, okay? What does he mean? Well, firstly, I want to make the point to you right now that this is not a passage about money. Not exclusively. Money is a part of it insofar as what you use with your money really does reflect the passion and heart you have in life, yeah? But this is not a passage exclusively about money. And I want to point out a few other things as well. This is not an anti-wealthy and pro-poverty passage, okay? The Bible is clear when it speaks about wealth and having wealth that it can be dangerous and can be very tempting for people, but it doesn't condemn it. And you notice Jesus doesn't say these evil wealthy people. That's not the point. And he doesn't say this godly woman in poverty. Again, not the point. I've met many godly people who are wealthy, many godly people who are poor, many greedy people who are wealthy, many greedy people who are poor. Wealth is neither a sign of someone's ungodliness, or I've got to make this really clear, it is not a sign of someone's godliness. It's not like God fills up your bank account the more prayers you make. That's not true. So it's not a pro-poverty or pro-wealth statement. But I also want to make it clear that this is not a statement where Jesus is saying you have to give everything to the church financially if you're going to be a Christian. It can't be. Because the Bible says we're to look after our families. We're to actually provide support for ourselves and for others with our money. From the wealth we have, we are to support the widows and the orphans and so on. So it can't be about giving away all your money. You ought to give it all away. So what is the point Jesus is making? Well, my friends, he is not making a statement about money, but about motivation. It's not the size of the gift that means anything. It's the place in the heart where the gift comes from. You see, we've seen hypocrisy. Living not for God, but for yourself. Achieving all the success that man can give you, but with an empty shell of a heart. And now we see authenticity, the real deal. What it actually looks like to be a follower of God. See, this woman is not noticeable because of the amount she gives. She's noticeable because of her radical generosity. She's noticeable because she is a woman whose house would have been devoured by these religious rulers. And yet out of that poverty inflicted by these evil men, she gives all she had. This is a statement about the heart of the believer. A heart that overflows of love for God and into all different areas and aspects of our life. Now let's get uncomfortable with each other. That's more than that. Let's turn the microscope off these people and put up a mirror. Let me ask you, who in this story best reflects you? Or maybe I should ask your spouse. Or maybe if you were following us around with a TV camera and other people were watching, what would they say? And please don't take this as a word of judgment from me. I'm guiltier. My friends, I think when we're honest with ourselves, we begin to realize that truthfully, we act far more like the teachers of the law than the widow, don't we? Now, our hypocrisy might not be as just flagrantly horrific as theirs, but it's still prevalent. It's still here. Our hypocrisy might be that you adjudge your soul to be higher than someone else's. You might even think of someone else in this room and you're like, I can't believe that person. Did you see what they put on Facebook? Did you see how they parent their kids? Did you see how they talk to each other? I'm much better than that. And we judge others with a standard that we'd be terrified if others used for ourselves. It might be that you're presenting a version of yourself to the outside world, maybe even here on a Sunday, but the truth of where you're actually at is something far, far different. It might be that you say one thing, but your life indicates that you act a completely different way. My friends, hypocrisy is like sweat. It just comes out of us. In the heat of life. But the truth is that even though all of us have that in common with each other, I don't think any of us here want it. Is there anyone here who wants to grow in hypocrisy? Anyone want to be a bigger hypocrite? If you do, come see me later. I'll give you tips, but no, like seriously, none of us want to be hypocrites. Doesn't matter even where you stand before God right now. If you're not a Christian, you're still like, yeah, I don't want to be a hypocrite. So how do we do it? How do we stop being hypocrites? How do we move our lives from being lives defined by hypocrisy to lives defined by radical generosity, authenticity? Or we actually have the answer in the actions of the widow. Think about it again. Think about her giving those two coins. What made her give like that? What was her motivation? Well, it wasn't to earn God's love. I'll give everything I have so God will love me. It wasn't to try and get higher in society and impress people at church. That's not why she gave. You see, this passage, what this passage does is it reminds us of words that Jesus has already said again and again and again. I mean, I've got to be really frank with you right now. Let me tell you something. It's the best news you'll ever hear. What does it cost you, anyone, to be a Christian? What does it cost you? Oh, man, it costs you nothing. Salvation is a free gift purchased for you by Jesus on the cross. Amen? Oh, how good's that? But what does it cost you to live as a Christian? What does it cost you to be a disciple of Jesus, to follow him? My friends, Jesus is clear. It will cost you everything. Luke chapter 14, you should check it out. If anyone would follow me, they must take up their cross and follow me. It will cost you everything. This widow reflects that for us, that to be a Christian is to be utterly committed to God, to love him more than you even love yourself, to have a passionate love for him that overwhelms every other passion in your life. And so when you live that way, it's not necessarily true that God will call you to give up everything you own. It's not necessarily true that God will call you to move to the other side of the world and be a missionary. But it is necessarily true that you must be willing to. And it is necessarily true that he might ask that. That's the call to discipleship. A call to love him, God and Jesus, above your own needs. Is that how you're living? How is it possible? Well, now we come to the moment where we've got a little bit of a plot twist. Like The Sixth Sense. Remember that movie? Bruce Willis is dead. You see, the hero of this story is not the widow. The hero of this story is Jesus. What do you think motivated that widow to act like that? Not buying God's love, not trying to impress others. What motivated her radical generosity was nothing more than a response to the radical generosity she'd received. You want to see love and sacrifice in action? Don't look at the widow. That's a snapshot. You want to see the full screen movie? Look to the cross. We respond with radical generosity in our lives when we truly understand what it cost Jesus for us to follow him. You see, what you might not know about Jesus' death on the cross is that the religious rulers, the teachers of the law, these guys, they were the ones who coordinated it. But they're not to blame, not really. Jesus chose to go to the cross. He chose to die. Why? Are you ready for this? This is great news. Because Jesus loves hypocrites. Why is that great news for us? Because we are hypocrites. Get your mind around this. Jesus died for the hypocrites who killed him. Jesus died so that hypocrites like the teachers of the law and hypocrites like you and you and you and you and me and me and me and me, that if we turn and repent and put our faith in him, we can be saved. Now that is radical generosity. Generosity given out of the love of God for you. You haven't earned it. He's given it to you. And that's what we see with the widow. The widow understands this. Jesus isn't dead yet, but she understands the great love of God as revealed to her in the Old Testament scriptures. And so her response is to abandon her own livelihood and put her trust and faith in God. Have you? This is what it means to be a Christian. And my friend, today, if you're here and you haven't yet put your faith and your trust in Jesus, I want to tell you something. We always got room for one more hypocrite. We're full of them, but we've got plenty of room for more. Come and join us. So what does that mean for us on a day-to-day basis right now? I'll finish with this. What does that mean for us? Well, let me tell you something right now. When you understand the radical generosity that's died for you on the cross so that you can live, it transforms how you not only view yourself, but view other people. You see, being a Christian means standing in judgment of other people, having higher standards for other people than you do for yourself. You can't do it. Because I can't look at any one of you and say, you're a worse sinner than me. Because I got a front row seat to my own sin. It's in my noggin all the time. So do you. So who am I to stand there and say, you shouldn't do this, you shouldn't do that? Don't get me wrong, we give each other direction through the Word of God and how we should live. But I cannot stand here. None of you can stand there and say, that person's worse than me because they've done this. Brother and sister, look in the mirror. We don't stand in judgment over other people. We love other people because we've been shown generosity from God. That's what true Christianity is. Living in the generosity of God. How does it play out in our lives? Well, I'll tell you some things it can look like and some things it definitely does look like. A life of radical generosity can mean that you decide to foster children, like Mark Benici fosters children. You decide to take in needy children, or you decide to care for widows and orphans. A life of radical generosity can mean that you get here early to direct traffic so our children can be safe in the car park, like Greg or Wayne or so many other brothers who do that. Or a life of radical generosity can mean that you decide to ask someone this week those 9 words. You sacrifice your time, your courage. Would you like to read the Bible with me? That's what it can mean. It can mean any of those things. But let me tell you what it definitely does mean. A life of radical generosity, of authenticity, of truly following Jesus means that you will not stand in judgment over other people as if you were better. You cannot, because you know that you're not. And a life of radical generosity, truly following Jesus, means that you must forgive people. I know that in this very congregation, we've got people who've been harmed and done true damage by other human beings. I know that's true. And I know how hard forgiveness is. But this isn't an optional extra. When you understand what you've been forgiven for, then you understand you must forgive people. It's a life where you must sacrifice your anger and your self-righteousness. It's a life where you give up the most precious of things, your time, to give to your church, to give to other people, to show the love of God. This widow, she was a victim. Her house had been devoured by alleged men of God. And yet she did not sit there and blame God. She did not sit there and say, well, I can't do this. This has happened to me. She gave it all for the one who gave it all for her. Amen? And shouldn't that be what we try to do from the minute we leave this place? Right now, let's start right now. Friends, let's pray. Our Father in heaven, thank you so much for your Son, Jesus. Lord, we thank you for his act of radical generosity to us on the cross. Oh, Lord, we do not deserve your love, but we have it. Lord, help all of us right now to live lives like this poor widow, this hero, this saint, this woman who considered her own livelihood nothing compared to living a life of honoring you and loving you. Help us to be people whose lives are defined not with self-love, not for love for other people, not for selfishness or selfish ambition, but whose lives are defined, utterly defined, by the love we've received from you and the love that we give to others. Lord, we pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. Friends.